So Hari Ghotra, 1 year on. So what is this all about? Well, Hari, she's a friend of mine, and she was about 18 months ago, she was a Tesco club card manager, and she had a side business. She did authentic Indian cooking lessons in people's homes. And so in the sort of Red Hill, Reigate area, she would go to your house, she would teach you how to cook authentic food, and then you can enjoy that food as a family or as a group of friends. She came to me and said, Rob, you know, I'm thinking I want to franchise this concept. I'm thinking I want more people to learn how to cook authentic Indian food. And I thought, yeah, well, that's kind of a great idea, but I went all Dragon's Den on her and I thought, you know what, you've got a bit of a lifestyle business. What happens if you show people? There's not much of a barrier to entry. So you start showing others how to go into people's homes and cooking Indian food. And what if they decide, well, why am I being paid a wage? Why don't I just do this myself? I also said, you know, what happens if they don't show up on a Friday night? Does that mean that you've got to go out there and conduct the lesson yourself? So we kind of had a conversation, and that conversation then led to more and more. A few glasses of wine or Prosecco led to me thinking, do you know what? Got a great idea. How about we build you as a brand online? How about we use things like Periscope or Google Hangouts? And how about we don't constrict you to just the region that you're in? How about we help you teach everyone, the world, to cook authentic Indian food? And that's pretty much where it began. So we said, okay, let's create a joint venture. Let's start the company Hari Ghotra and leave Tesco and let's make this project happen. And this is kind of, there's a short video now to what we said right.
For me, cooking, it's about bringing great ingredients together. It's about sharing. It's about getting your hands in there. It's about being messy. And I think if you cook with love, if you cook with passion, whatever you produce is gonna taste amazing. And that's what I wanna do through Hari Ghotra, really.
So when we talk about a case study that can demonstrate Jellyfish's services and what we're able to offer our clients, it was a no-brainer, I think, for myself and Jellyfish to partner with Hari to bring this whole project to life.
No, I've never been in front of a camera. All of those bits and pieces that, you know, you never thought that you would ever be doing, I've literally been thrown into them. So for me, it's been, and it still is, a huge learning curve.
And we want Jellyfish to feel, with all that we have to contribute, we just want to, you know, feel like the arm around, just say, you'll be all right, you'll be all right. We've got your back, you know. It's a big undertaking, what we're doing, and what we want to get out of it is actually we want to demonstrate that we can create a star online. Big ambitions. So we started from scratch, a ferociously competitive marketplace. You've got, you know, if you look on the first page, you go to Indian food recipes, you've got the BBC, well, more than one BBC website. Jamie Oliver's got that space. There's food.com. There's so many different areas. So can we, from scratch, build a brand online? And what were we trying to do? Well, ultimately, we were trying to create the perfect case study. busy year, basically. So what were we trying to do? If we can see if this will stick now we've played the video, is we wanted to create the perfect case study. What were we trying to do? Well, we wanted to make sure that we demonstrated that as an organization, we can build every asset possible. So everything from recipe photography to the video production, basically we wanted to make sure that we can create every single asset that's possible. We wanted to make sure that we can facilitate a campaign on every single channel. We wanted to make sure that every single one of our assets rendered correctly on every device. And then we wanted to make sure that we can measure, optimize, and continue to amplify the activity that's online. So where are we now? So hits to date, 225,747. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about our paid strategy versus our earned media strategy. And I don't know whether that's impressive or not. I know that what we've done is we've created a lot of content. What I know is that we've had a very authentic strategy and it's led to some great things, but we don't know whether that's great or not. What we have learned as an organization is that when you're trying to do something in an authentic way, you've got to be patient. And secondly, the growth is not linear. What we believe is that it's a bit like pushing a bus off a cliff. You know, there's a lot of effort that goes in at the beginning, and then all of a sudden you hit that tipping point and then it takes off. We believe we're close to that tipping point because everything is happening in an exponential way. If I were to do this presentation next year, I'm pretty sure the number's gonna be considerably higher than 225,000. But let's just tell you, it's warts and all. We're just trying to tell you, this is a project we did and these are the results. So we've only managed to get 379 people to join the email list. But we don't do a lot of activity around that. I mean, that's something that we're gonna start to do in the future. But it's interesting. When I did this presentation last year, the YouTube subscribers were 39, we had just begun, and we had 1,446 views on YouTube. As you can see, we're now on 1,621 highly engaged subscribers, and that's the point. With all of our social channels, we haven't used any of the tools to amplify and enhance your followings. So they're absolutely authentic following for each of those channels. And as you can see, we've now got in excess of 160,000 views on YouTube. And again, that is growing exponentially. 2014, we had 338 Facebook likes. We've now got 1,539. Twitter, we had 572 followers. And now we've got 1,346. Now, again, not very impressive numbers, I thought. But when you look at the 1,346, if we just took the top 50 followers, they have a following of 17.5 million. So the type of people that are following Hari and are engaging, if we just got two or three retweets, we're getting immense exposure from it. So again, this is because of the authentic strategy. Google Plus. 36 to 129. Now, this is another place that we're going to focus quite a lot because, as all of you may know, that if you've got Google Plus followers, it has a great advantage on the Google search landscape. The way in which the alerts work gives us a lot of exposure. So there's going to be a little bit of activity around increasing the Google Plus. Pinterest, very visual. Food is very visual. And we've gone from 23. I mean, we've had 207 followers, but we've got a hell of a lot of likes for the photos that she posts. And then Instagram, 33 to 263 followers. Again, I'm not judging whether they're impressive or not. All I do know is that all of this social activity and what's happening out there has had a profound effect on, before we say that, we've got Vine, 834 followers. We've actually got one of the Vines that Harry's got has had like 650,000 loops. So there's a lot of activity, again, happening around that. But the most important thing is what we found is this authentic social strategy actually has the desired effect. We know that on the Google landscape, for example, we're told, make it authentic. Don't try and game the system. Don't try and beat the algorithm. Well, now, if you look at it, those numbers may have seemed quite low, but the impact of that is that if you type in some very generic terms like Lambuna, we're number one on the organic landscape. If you type in chicken passanda, as you can see, we're three. Vegetable pakora, we're number one. And there's a whole plethora of terms where we're starting to feature on the Google organic landscape. And when we look at the mix of traffic that we're getting, you will see how much organic has played a part. So last year we looked at the gender split, and it was 52 female, 48 male. Obviously the data set, I would hardly say we had statistical significance at this point, but as time's gone on, as you can see, the numbers have got higher, and we've seen the trend changing more towards females. Now that could be a lot to do with the sort of Prima exposure that we've had, or where we're placing. We're on sites like Food Gawker and Foodly, and I don't know whether their demographic profile is different, but what we're learning is that it changes, it depends. It's very organic what's happening out in the landscape. We also looked at the territories that we were getting exposure in. And as you can see, the US down there at like 6.31%, the UK was accounted for 84%. But as we started getting the exposure in on the landscape, you can see the UK is down to 55%. And the US is right up at 18%. You can see that we're getting quite a decent level of exposure. The behavior on the website. So we were looking at new visitors versus returning visitors. What's really interesting is the parity between the new and the returning in 2014. You can see they're around the 3, maybe the average session views is a bit less for the new visitors. But we have 60-40. Well, we've now got 71% new visitors. And as you can see, the returning visitors are absolutely using the site and staying on the site longer and engaging more than the new visitors. And there's a little bit of a strategy we've used, which I'll explain in a second as well. The channels, that's very interesting as well. So as you can see, the organic is at 12%, social at 51. Social at 51, that could be a little bit skewed because obviously we were launching the brand, we were encouraging all of the people within the Jellyfish organization to share. It was a lot of Harry's friends, my friends, you know, people within the organization. So there was a lot of social activity. But as we went on, as you can see, organic is now raised to 46%. Direct is up at 14.8%, and social down at 10. But what the interesting thing is, you may see now, there's a paid search strategy at 10%. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the budgets, because it's quite important. We can talk about all these numbers and all the activity. I'm going to show you some of the assets and what the amount of money we've spent. But the paid search strategy is quite interesting. So what we've done is we've tried to use the earned and organic traffic, and we've only ever used paid search to amplify the experience. So only if you've seen the website, been on a website or one of our assets, will you then start to see paid activity. Why did we do that? Well, we're using things like remarketing lists for search, so that if you know, we need click-through rates. We haven't got the money to spend. Traffic is very expensive. And so what we wanted is we wanted to ensure that our click-through rates were as high as possible. And the way to do that is that I know if you imagine how your behavior is, when you go online, we don't always look at the ad copy nowadays. We just look at the URLs and see, is this a brand that I recognize? Is this a brand that I trust? Is this one that I want to engage with? So the only way to do that is that we will only show you a paid search ad if you know the Hari Ghotra brand and are likely to click on it. What we found is that our quality score soared through the roof. We got impressive click-through rates. Our cost per clicks came down, and it was a sustainable strategy to build out in that way. We're doing exactly the same. It's all remarketing with our display activity. So social channels, how did it all mix? You know, 81% Facebook, again, that's probably due to the friend strategy and the fact that it's all people that we knew. It's right down to 31% now. As you can see, we've got some of the bookmarking sites coming on, Twitter's increasing, you're seeing YouTube increasing as well. But this is all referral traffic. Like I said, we're getting a lot of views on YouTube anyway. Devices, not much to note on this. We just talked about it in 2014, so we thought we'd share that information. One thing that's notable is the change in the tablets. So going from 14% up to 21%. That might be the sort of dual screening, the YouTube. We're not entirely sure. But I know what you're thinking.
Show me the money!
Traffic's all well and good, but we need to actually be able to afford this activity. Now, we're using the case study as an organization, so that's okay. We're using it as a case study. We could put some marketing budget, but the idea is to try and get to a situation where we're getting some sort of ROI on all of this activity. So the second phase, the new phase of the website is coming out. These are the wireframes. You're going to see little things that we've got. So the first one is the whisk widget. So this is a little widget that allows you to purchase the ingredients from any of the stores, whether it's Asda, Tesco, Ocado, Waitrose, it doesn't matter. You can actually use this widget to buy those ingredients. We've got the spice kits, so we're going to have an e-commerce store, and most of the popular recipes, we will have a supporting spice kit. You've all got one spice kit in your digital journey bags, so all you have to do, every single one of them has a supporting video to show you how to cook that recipe. Equipment sales. As you look at the videos, you're going to want all the proper equipment, the pots, the pans, pestle and mortars, the spices, etc., aprons, you name it. Ads. So we're now making sure that we can also serve ads, relevant ads. And again, due to the authentic nature and the engagement of the audience, we think we can certainly demand quite high cost per thousand amounts. We've got lots of partners. You know, Soul Tree Wine, which is an Indian wine. We've got beer company. We've got a grill company. So lots of people that want to partner and sponsor and I'm absolutely interested in the audience that we're creating. We've also going to have the Real Curry Club. Now, this is where you can subscribe. You get access to Hari, possibly Hangouts and Periscopes, exclusive offers. You're going to get sent a kit, possibly even the ingredients. We're actually scoping out exactly what that's going to look like. But what we want is that you can subscribe, and maybe on a Thursday night, every Thursday night, you've got all the ingredients and the kit and a video, and you could possibly cook along with an audience. We're just working out exactly what that proposition is. But again, until we had the audience, we couldn't really think about how we were going to monetize the activity. How much did it all cost? Now, I'm not sure. Is that a scary figure? I don't know. There's a lot of big brands in here. But one of the things to point out, and we're going to show why, but if we were to bill for the amount of, for the video and photography, it would have come up to, over the last 12 months, it would have come up to 190,000. As you can see, we have to build a lot of campaign assets. The original website, 35,000. We've only spent 1,200 on paid media, which is because of our remarketing strategy. We've had the SEO retainer. We had to make sure the tracking was set up correctly. There's some promotional merchandise like the kits, aprons, and some cards, etc. But as you can see, quite a considerable investment's gone into the brand. So let's have a look. So how many videos have we produced? Right, so we're on 189 videos right now. And so the YouTube channel has been completely built out. And like I say, we're starting to get, we've got some of the videos online which are like at 32, 34,000 views. And what we found is that once you hit that tipping point, obviously we get more and more. What else have we done? Well, we've created all HTML5 banners. There's a whole range of them. This is just some of the creative that we've done. We've produced infographics. So that we can actually have engaging, interesting content out there that we can attract audiences. Recipe photos, we've got 205 recipes that we had to do a full photo shoot. We had to cook the food, then do a photo shoot. And what did this all lead to? So there is an unexpected twist to the end. What we knew is that we wanted to build a brand. We wanted to actually show that online we can create a presence that would attract people to the Hari Ghotra brand. And the last thing we expected was this. Tamarin of Mayfair. Now, I don't know whether you know anybody here. Raise your hands if you know Tamarin of Mayfair. There's two that do. Okay, quite a few in the room. So this was the first Michelin star Indian food restaurant in London. And they've now had it for a few years. And the Tamarin Collection, we are a big shout out. We've actually got Fateh and Raoul from Tamarin here with us today. So let me tell you this story. Now, this was amazing for us. So Hari had went to the Tamarin of Mayfair restaurant and had, it's basically North Indian cuisine and obviously Michelin star. So it was a very exciting experience for her. And she absolutely loved the food. And she could, it really resonated with her. She could definitely relate to the type of dishes. So she actually contacted Peter Joseph and made contact with the head chef over there and just wanted to say, wow, what a lovely experience I had. And what a great, thing it was to see that authentic North Indian cooking is being being produced in London. And of course, what to our surprise, Peter said, you know, well, I know you. Harry, I've seen your videos. I know what you're about, and I love what you're doing. And so Harry, obviously, she was absolutely delighted. And then the conversations happened, and then I started talking to Fateh and Raoul, and we ended up having a discussion and saying, do you know what? We think there's definitely a tie here. You know, we think that what you're doing online and the exposure and the brand and the authenticity of what you're doing, we're really interested in. So the conversation carried on, and now we're in a situation where Harry is working. She's doing a few shifts. She's working in the Mayfair, Tamarin of Mayfair restaurant with Peter Joseph. But the biggest and most exciting thing is that they're opening Tamarin Kitchen in Soho and potentially more restaurants. And the plan is to appoint Harry as the executive chef of that chain of restaurants. So in 12 months, we've gone from no one would ever know who Hari Ghotra was, and there was nothing online, to the point where we're now going to represent one of the, well, probably, I should say, the best chain of Indian restaurants in the UK. So that was a really, really big, we didn't expect to be attracting a restaurant, and we've got massive plans for the brand now, and are very, very excited. So this was just a bit, just to show you that actually, if we're thinking about the moral of the story, is that it requires patience. Sometimes the numbers don't come as quickly as possible. We don't have to use all those tools to artificially amplify your numbers. Authenticity seems to be the secret. And the genuine human interaction with what you're putting out online is getting results. And often, it's the most important people, the influencers, the people who can make a change that are engaging with your brand, that will ultimately have the biggest difference. Hopefully, we may tell a story and see you next year.